Israel has been our number one geography. Obviously, a smaller country, and most of our dollars are not deployed in Israel, but it has been our single best performing geography for the last 15 years since our first investment in 2005.
Thank you very much. Just to give you a drop of history, and then I'm going to ask my panelists to come up and join me on stage. So I reached out to John Medved when I read a small clip in one of the newspapers 2 years before he started OurCrowd, telling me that he's starting this this company that was going to be a crowdfunding of Israeli technology. I have been, as Alex said, I've been obsessed, as Alan said, I've been obsessed with Israeli technology for many years before that. So I reached out to John, and our first meeting was at his favorite cafe called the Grand Cafe. And I said to him, John, I don't want to hear about what you're doing. I read about it. I've been studying your history for a long time. I said, I want in. I want to be side by side with John Medved in investing in Israeli technology and the Israeli future. So I am obsessed, and I'll continue to be. Please God, it should be successful. So if I can ask my panelists, Eran, Anders, and Yuda to come up on stage and take your seats at the couch, please. Thank you, that's great. Sit, please. I'll come over in a couple of minutes. I'm going to rotate between here and there. So what I'm going to start with is I'm going to ask each of the panelists to spend 2 to 3 minutes introducing yourself and talking about what you do and what you do specifically in Israel. If I can let you go, Anders, why don't you start?
Yeah, Anders Thulin, Triton Partners. We're a private equity firm. We have about 12 billion assets under management with a footprint in Europe mainly. And we are investing in four sectors broadly. It's the consumer, healthcare, industrial, and what we call business services. And as you noticed, we don't have a sector called tech. So why we are here, we're a group from Triton here, we've been here before, is because we believe tech is actually within all sectors and with all companies. So for us, it's very important to be here to connect and find the right type of startups that we believe can be a win-win partnership with our portfolio company. That's the short
That's great.
Intro.
Thank
and
you.
Really good to be here.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. Eran, could I get 3 to 3 minutes on you and your company and what you do?
Sure. Good morning, everybody. Eran Gorev. I am with Francisco Partners. We're a San Francisco-based, tech-focused private equity firm. All we do is technology. Primarily buyouts, about 80% of our deals are buyouts, controlled transactions, and the rest are minority deals. I've been with the firm for 7 years now. Prior to Francisco Partners, I was on the operating side, computer science background. I was a software engineer, moved into sales and marketing, and later on general management. And again, joined Francisco Partners 7 years ago. We were actually the first ones to pursue a tech buyout here in Israel back in 2005, so that was way before I joined, with a company Jerusalem-based called Ex Libris. And since then, we made 10 investments here, over $1.5 billion of US dollars deployed. We had a number of different exits over the last few years, very successful ones, and we still own a number of companies here.
Thank you very much. Yuda, yeah, by the way, before Yuda talks, I just want to say that when I sent him the questions and set up a conference call yesterday, I didn't realize that Yuda is a very close friend of my brother and my sister-in-law. And I get this note in the middle of the night from my sister-in-law. Her name is Christina Cooper. She's a famous cellist who lives in Israel, and she said, be nice to Yuda. So Yehuda, please, say a few words.
Yeah, well, it was an amazing coincidence, you know, yesterday night. I'm Yuda Doron, I'm a general partner in a firm called Greenfield. And we do early growth a little bit before the private equity. We come after the VCs. We invest checks of about $25 million in tech and tech-enabled companies. When we need a bigger check, we teamed up. We partner with a big mega private equity firm from the Bay Area called TPG. And we basically deployed in Israel probably in the last few years, probably about, you know, $500 million and a little bit more of money to a growth company.
So as an investor in TPG, I'm real happy to see Yehuda up here talking about his investments in Israeli technology or the Israeli scene. So let's start with the question that I'm sure is interesting most people in the audience. For many years, private equity and venture capital were on opposite ends of the investing platform. People would say, we don't do VC, we don't do technology, because the whatever reason, maybe the exits take too long. Whatever it is, the world has changed. And I'd love to hear from you why the world has changed and why private equity is interested now in technology, and even more specifically, Israeli technology. So I'll start with Yuda, since you finished last.
Yeah, so private equity, typical private equity, is looking for, you know, lower risk, high return, low return. They're looking for mature company, people that establish their market, establish their product. Technology risk is out of the way. The team is crystallized, you know, something more mature. You know, Israel, again, as people said before, is turning from a startup nation to a scale-up nation. You know, years ago, technology people in Israel, all they cared about was technology. They wanted to get a fast exit and move on and start the next company. Today, it changed. People really look to establish themselves in the market, grow company, go public. And to do that, you need large capital, but capital is just part of the equation. You actually need help in the target market. You need network. You need people that can help you short the cycles from people, from technology, from prospect. And those private equity in the U.S. and in Europe are really helping beyond capital. And Israel is a fruitful ground for larger companies that like to stay in business for a longer time.
Thank you. Eran?
Yeah, I agree with what Yuda said. I still think the Israeli tech scene is a hybrid or a combination of startups, obviously, and scale-up. So I think it has evolved. I don't know that it moved from being a startup nation, the country and the tech scene here, to a scale-up nation. But I agree that with IPO markets being a little different today, and more companies and founders, management teams, and even investors realize that an IPO may not be the preferred or the ideal exit scenario for the company or for themselves as investors, that's where private equity and other types of capital come in. And like Yuda mentioned, we would come in, we would allow early stage investors to exit the business with a very nice return from their perspective, allow the founders and the management team, the employees, to take some money home, effectively take some chips off the table, but continue to maintain a stake, an equity stake in the business, and then work with us as the controlling shareholder on continuing to scale the business. So there's a lot of innovation still in Israel, and hopefully that will continue for many years to come. But it's not enough to have innovation and great technology. You need to be able to take that technology in a very competitive way, very attractive way to market. And the methodologies, the processes, the global go-to-market, these are things that the Israeli tech scene did not necessarily excel at, you know, earlier in. And this is where private equity and other people come in and can truly help the Israeli startup community to succeed.
Terrific. Thank you. Anders, please.
I mean, back to your question about if there is, blurring between venture capital and private equity, I would say that it's still very different to invest in my mind, in venture capital versus private equity. However, there is something happening, which is that we have 45 portfolio companies. I would say that venture debt, all of them need to do a lot to accelerate growth, accelerate innovation, and leverage technology much better. And I think you can do that. And all of them, of course, they're their own, technology and R&D. But one way to accelerate is actually to partner with other tech companies and when it makes sense to acquire them. So we have, if you look at our portfolio, we have had about 20 add-ons that have been technology companies, combination of, strong partnership, but also acquired them. And I think that's a way for us to make sure that we stay on the edge when it comes to technology within all the sectors, and we need to do much more. And then, of course, it has to be win-win, and in those situations, well, why would a small tech company or a smaller tech company would like to join a private equity-owned large company, more maybe traditional? And I think one reason is actually access to the market. And we have acquired a few companies that had fantastic technology, but they didn't have the go-to-market. But they actually got that, and it was really win-win. And then, of course, you have to make sure that they also have the right incentives, they reinvest in the new business, et cetera, et cetera. But so far, so good. So that's what we're trying to accomplish. And about your question about being in Israel, I think it's pretty obvious. I mean, there are few hubs in the world where you find so many people, so many companies that are really, into real innovation, real technology, and leveraging that in business. So that's why we're here.
Great. So one problem that part of my legal practice is representing private equity firms in all sorts of different spaces. I've probably done more private equity investment in all different fields, like real estate and technology, et cetera. One of the problems we see in the real estate world is that when private equity is a partner in a real estate transaction, they have a timeline. They have a 7-year timeline, sometimes a 10-year timeline, and it creates issues when you're closing on the end of the timeline for the fund. In terms of putting in future capital, et cetera, investment period might be over. Is that a problem when it comes to technology companies, or is it different because technology companies are acquisitions that you live through to fruition? Yuda?
So I like to distinguish between private equity. I mean, we have actually two or three categories of private equity. One is just the mega guys. They go to institution, get the money. The other one is VC that raise some fund to have a arm of private equity. And of course, you have strategics, that are people that are looking for technology innovation for them. In our field, in high tech, 10 years is a lot of time. I mean, if you are not successful in a 7 or 10 years span, you're not going to be successful. The market moves so quickly. There's so much competitive. There's so much innovation. Technology by itself is really a small part of the whole success. I mean, you start with it, but it's basically diminished very quickly. And so private equity is not just the fund. It's not just the capital. It's basically the connection, the network, that everything around a startup or, a technology startup that needs in the market. So actually 6 to 10 years is really a long time, was never a problem. Again, when you get to the end of the life cycle, basically other transactions happen. But you need to distinguish between those two, and when you get capital as an entrepreneur or as a young company, you really need to align your objective, what you're up to, what do you need with those private equity, and make sure that you basically align with their objective.
Thank you.
Right. Yeah, I agree again. Remember what Yuda said in his answer to an earlier question. Private equity usually comes in, certainly ourselves. We come in after the success of a company has been proven. So most of our companies have positive EBITDA, have positive free cash flow. And so we know the market and we invest quite a bit because we focus exclusively on tech and specific sectors in technology. We know those sectors quite well. We follow companies for a long time. We invest a lot in the diligence of those businesses. And so the question mark around, is there a market primarily, has been answered. Is the product the right product? We know the answer. Is the management team and the company, are they in the right place in the ecosystem? We know the answer to that as well. So you can ask yourself, what's the objective, or why do we come in, and why is it of interest to the company itself? Many of our companies have been around for 10, 15, or even 20 years, and some of the early investors do want out because of their, you know, life cycle or time span for their own investments. And we service an exit opportunity in this regard. But when we come in, there's a well-formulated thesis that not always works exactly as we envisioned it, but we have a very clear thesis and view on how we can create value. And when I say we, it's the collective we, the management team, the employees, of course, and ourselves being the owners, the new owners of the business. Whether it's follow-on M&A, whether it's go-to-market things, again, processes, other things that we help a company continue down the path of establishing itself as a leader in its own specific domain. And in this regard, as was said, 5 or 10 years is certainly a very long time because these are established businesses. We typically implement those, the different elements of our thesis within the first year or two, and then we start seeing the results, hopefully the good results of those changes and transformations or add-on acquisitions and such very, very shortly thereafter. So within 3 to 4 years, we know where the company is heading, and we already start seeing the returns on those investments.
Great. Anders?
I mean, I think it's very individual, but I mean, if you look at most companies, they go through stages, and in the different stages, they need different type of ownership, typically. And I think for quite a few that are, I agree with you, when they're more established, that type of environment that a good private tech with the owner can provide can be extremely fruitful. And it could be different things that they need depending on the situation. As I said before, I think the companies that we are investing more in, if I may call it traditional companies, particularly if we compare with you. But if we look at the tech investments, it has been a lot around, you know, go to market. And I think there a private tech with the firm can support. There were probably other areas as well, but I think there are a natural stage when private equity firm might be a really good home for a founder and for the team, the management team.
Great. So John made me promise that I wouldn't ask just routine questions. He said, shake them up a little bit. So I'm gonna ask a question that you may or may not be prepared for. I do a lot of restructuring work. I restructure companies that are in trouble. One of my latest clients that I took on in October is a company, a small company called WeWork. I'd love to hear from you guys, what is your worst investment in Israeli technology? And I'd like to hear what you've done to try to either fix it or just walk away. And then you can reverse that by telling me your best investment, just really quickly. Okay, Yuda.
Yeah, well, so we don't talk about the bad stuff, but we are, you know, private equity in general, it's not a VC. It's meaning every investment counts. For us, every investment in the private equity world or in the early growth world is count. Meaning, it's not like a, you know, VC that invested in 10 or 20, whatever, in and 10% or 20% or 30% of making it. For us, every investment count, and it start at the due diligence time, meaning that when we go to a company and we conduct due diligence, look at the market, look at the team, we basically generate a lot of knowledge, a lot of information, we have a lot of advisor. We ourselves, coming from operational background, myself, you know, I started a company and sold it, you know, went public, sold it, so I have a lot of experience. My partners have a lot of experience. So we basically diving in at the process of the due diligence. And once we finish, we take all the information and we give to the company. Now, companies that we say no, not now because it's too early or whatever, became our biggest fan, Gamma, our biggest reference, because we work with them. Now, of course, if we invest, we get in and we take care of them as if it's our only companies. That's the difference between VC and private equity. So we do not basically lose money. Sometimes we don't make, you know, 5-6 times our money. We don't aim for it. You know, private equity is looking for a lower return, but we don't basically go to zero or things like this. So so we don't have like bad outputs, outcome. We always find a way to sell the technology, to sell the company or whatever, and basically return our investment as a minimum. And of course, we have a lot of success that basically sustain our profit, and we show our private you know, investor that it's good to invest with us. That's basically kind of a, John, where are you tackling us?
Okay, Eran.
So our loss ratio has been very low. We don't tend to walk away from any company, and we do our diligence and try to make sure that the risk is pretty low and well managed. But to your question, Phil, about best and worst investment, Israel, by the way, for FP and Francisco Partners, is a U.S.-based private equity, global private equity firm. Israel has been our number one geography, obviously a smaller country, and most of our dollars are not deployed in Israel, but it has been our single best-performing geography for the last 15 years since our first investment in 2005. And we've been successful in generating returns for our investors of over 3x, which for private equity is definitely the golden standard. We've had some exits here in Israel, over $1 billion each, like Click Software, just 3-4 months ago. We sold it to Salesforce for $1.4 billion. We had another exit company that some people may say was somewhat controversial, NSO Group, that we exited at $1 billion. And so we've been very successful here. Thank God we haven't had a worst investment, or at least not a bad, but not a bad one. The worst return that we've generated over the 15 years has been just sub 3x, so 2.8x our money, which is still great for private equity. And that was years back when we were a little too quick to sell, but for different reasons.
Just so I should know, are you taking new money? I want to answer the questions in the crowd.
We are.
Okay, good.
Show me a fund that isn't.
Okay, great. Anders.
Okay, so first of all, I would say I wish we actually have invested more in Israel. So I will give you a few examples also outside Israel. But of the 20 companies I mentioned, we had acquired in the tech space or partnered with, two of them are Israel-based, so we're not that active in Israel. I mean, that's why we're here. We would like to be more active. But back to your question. So first of all, before failures, maybe some success stories in our world. So we are in healthcare. So we bought one of the leading healthcare providers in the Nordics, and they were completely non-tech. And I think everybody know that healthcare is moving, you know, super fast into tech. So we did an add-on acquisition of a complete tech company, healthcare. And what we also did was that we took the CEO of that company and made him CEO of the whole company. And that became an extreme success because he could combine his knowledge, his team, with the incumbent team. And it, of course, it's a culture thing, but it worked out very well. And he took that company into the leading provider, both, you know, in the physical world and the digital world, with a patient-centric journey, and using AI for diagnosis, triage, et cetera, et cetera. I'm not going to talk more about it, but that is one of the success stories. We sold that company with great returns to another private equity firm, and they take that journey further. So I think that's an example of how we try to leverage tech with add-ons. If I take a failure relating to tech, and again, it's not a big failure, but it's not where it should be. But you know, it's when we acquired a industrial company and we underestimated the technology legacy in that company. We thought actually It would have been easier to turn that around in terms of new product introduction, innovation, new technology. And that was much more legacy and took much more longer time and therefore longer, lower returns, which is a way to really be careful when you look into companies today. We now spend a lot of time doing the DD, particularly in the tech area, to make sure we avoid those type of things going forward. But that was not an Israeli situation, by the way. But
got it. Terrific. So I'm going to put on my investment banker hat, and if anybody would like subscription documents from any of their funds, I'll be standing here ready to take your names. Also, if anybody wants to invest in WeWork, just come forward and tell me. I'll be able to figure out a role for you.
Good luck with that one.
As lawyers, we bill by the hour, so just remember that. So, thank God. So I want to know, what advice would you give to the companies that are in the audience in terms of what they can do to interest you in their product and their companies? Is there something special? Just give me one piece of advice for the companies out there. I'll start with Eran, this one.
So ironically, and maybe not ironically, but we're most interested when there's a real opportunity to create value, which means, by definition, that some things have to not work really well at the present time. Now, I don't know how many companies would admit it, would necessarily acknowledge or recognize it, but we invest, we're late stage investors, obviously, private equity, we're typically the last money in. But if there are any companies, any founders, any CEOs here that have an interest or feel that a solid private equity team with strong operational background and deep knowledge of different sectors and strategic partnerships with the likes of Salesforce and Google and Microsoft and Apple, things, again, that we bring to bear when we work with companies, and you want a partner to help you take your company to the next level, then we're happy to take your call or take a meeting and see if it's a real opportunity for us.
Great. Anders?
I mean, I think I shouldn't sit and give advice to companies here. Rather, I really would like to encourage them to also seek out us, because we are, I think if you look a little bit from the outside, we are more of a traditional private equity firm. But I think we are very attractive for tech companies to either partner or also potential investments. And I think that is not so common. I think most of the tech companies, they think more on the tech, private equity firms. But I think this is a big change. And we are one of the more traditional private equity firms that are moving aggressively into tech. So please also think about that. And particularly if you're in the healthcare sector, or in the industrial, or in everything regarding agriculture, we also have investments there, and then of course the consumer space, particularly in transportation and different type of services in that sector. So please link up. We're here. We're a team of 10 people here, and we're very happy to meet during those days. Thanks.
Yuda, I'm going to let you finish it off. I just realized that there's a clock right here telling me how much time we have left. Yuda.
I'll speak quicker than normal. So, the audience of OurCrowd is normally come from early stage VC. And, when private equity look at things, we really like to see, again, we see technology. We like to see innovation, although it's a short time that you basically have some advantage, but technology, and you divide the technology with real, innovation, me too, or a new stuff, an enabler. We like to see the, technology that can really grow into a big market. So immediately when we get in, those are the two things we look at. And of course the team, some experience in technology, people that establish the technology and need help in the market, we are the right firm to come in early stage, even before the private equity, work with you guys, explore the market and basically take you and try to help in the target market. And if somebody need help in the target market beyond technology, because we cannot compete with you all on the technology, we're here to try and help.
Terrific. I just want to say that this is a major, major, major positive product of what's going on in the Israeli ecosystem, that you've got three major players and many others coming to Israel, being successful with the Israeli companies and Israeli technology. And I just want to give a round of applause for our three panelists, and thanks.